products in Mombasa is where certainly the prices dropped, and factories, instead of actually getting to address the issues, they certainly resorted to closing down. Now this has trickled down to the outgrowers, farmers across the country, and certainly the other factories that are still surviving in businesses are downsizing on their staff. What can government do to ensure that this is rectified? And also, what are the representatives of the people think about this issue? To discuss this and more, here are two guests. One is Twesigo Mhanji. Barnabas is the company secretary for Uganda Tea Outgrowers Association. He's already in studio. Thank you so much for joining me this morning.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Mbarak.
Also, via Zoom, we'll be joined by the Igara East Member of Parliament, and that's Honorable Gaffa Mbwatekama. We'll be coming in through via Zoom, and of course, we'll be talking to him from his constituency. But before we get to him, let's first talk with Mr. Barnabas about this issue of tea. How much effect is on the ground, and how do we get to the point of having the crisis that we are actually evidencing in the industry?
Yeah, thank you very much once again, Mr. Mbarak. The tea farmers are facing a lot of challenges. This has been brought about by a number of factors, but majorly, probably we have to talk about some of these problems that are hitting us. The main problem is about low farm gate prices. Low farm gate prices, I mean the amount of money that the farmers are getting from their produce, from their farms, is extremely low. In the recent past, for example, I may give you an example. In the recent past, we about 2 years ago, a farmer was getting around 670 shillings.
Out farm gate.
A farm gate, a kilo of green leaf. As we speak now, a farmer is getting between 150 and 200 shillings. And this, vis-a-vis the amount of inputs, the amount of price that we put into the inputs, especially the fertilizers. Now, government, you could have also realized that there has been an increase in the recent past, about 3-4 years ago, there was an increase in the production of tea in Uganda. Government invested a lot in the farmers. They encouraged farmers to grow tea. They supplied free tea seedlings to farmers. Encouraged some areas to open up areas, some areas which never grew tea before. They were encouraged to grow tea. Areas of West Nile, some areas of Ruchiga, southwestern Uganda, areas of Kabarak Soro, Ntungamo, Mitoma. So many other areas were encouraged to open up and grow tea. And as such, production increased. As production increased, government did not take into cognizance of the fact that the tea is going to increase, but there is going to be little processing capacity of this tea. So we've got tea increased, the production increased.
In the production,
it increased. As a result of that deliberate action by government to supply free tea seedlings, and they spent billions of money.
Yes.
Now it increased, the production increased. And the absorption capacity by the processing factories
in Uganda,
it was low. And as such, we've had problems, especially now at peak periods, you find the tea is too much, and the factories cannot absorb it, and it is dumped. In the dry seasons, when it has reduced, that's when they receive the tea.
Yes.
As we speak, like I talked about the price, we are getting 150 in some areas, 150 to 200 shillings. Now, a placa takes 100 shillings in some areas, or even 130 shillings from the 200 shillings that you're getting from a kilo of green leaf. Now, as a farmer.
In how much time
yes.
has this happened?
In the past, like 2 years, this is what has been happening.
I mean, in the past 2 years,
yes.
Isn't that actually after COVID? Could it be related to COVID-19?
No, not necessarily. There are quite a number of other reasons other factors that have led to this. For example, we talk of the global reduction of tea
consumption
brought about majorly by the wars in the Middle East, war in Russia, and so on and so forth. Yes, that contributed to the low intake of tea by these areas, which used to take a lot of our tea. But there are quite a number of other factors. Now, for example, Uganda, our price is low on the auction market in Mombasa.
Mm.
The price is low of our tea, vis-a-vis, compared to areas like countries like Rwanda and Kenya. Whereas now our tea here, we sell at the auction market, we sell our tea in Mombasa.
Mm.
That's where we've got our auction. Whereas we sell our tea less than a dollar shillings, we get around 7 cents a kilo of processed tea. Rwanda gets more than $3, around $3.7 a kilo of processed tea.
Mm.
You understand?
Yes.
You see the variance.
The disparity.
The disparity.
What informs that disparity? Quality, quantity?
Absolutely.
Now, supply?
It is majorly the quality. It is majorly the quality. Our quality in Uganda is low. It is poor. It's poor as compared to Rwanda and Kenya. It is poor. And as such, that has now coupled with the wars and low consumption of tea in the countries that majorly took tea, now our quality becomes poor. And Uganda is losing billions of money in Mombasa.
All right.
Now, the major problem, probably I may explain this, the major problem that brings about this low quality tea from Uganda is the lack of regulation. Our people in the tea, we are not regulated at all. Whereas countries like Rwanda have got regulatory authorities, regulatory bodies,
yes.
to help maintain the standards.
But you have a whole Ministry of Agriculture.
Yes.
I saw certainly the authorities you're talking about. Of
yes.
course, regulation is quite a much bigger issue. But I want to bring in Honorable Mbwate Kama before actually we come to regulation and all that. Honorable, thank you so much for joining us this morning. Please, if you could brief us what exactly is going on in your constituency, because we know most of the tea farmers are around your constituency. And how did we get to this point? Unfortunately, I can't hear Honorable Mbwate Kama. Of course, we'll get back to him later. Barnabas, you are talking about actual regulation. Before we get to regulation, how much tea is produced by outgrowers, by your actual farmers, and how many people do you have in your association?
We have thousands of farmers from all these tea growing districts, over 33 districts in Uganda. We have got the total amount of tea that is produced in Uganda, 69% is produced by these outgrowers. All the tea that is produced in Uganda.
Close to 70%.
Close to 70%. And these are statistics from, we've got what we call UTA, Uganda Tea Association, and these are statistics they've provided, at least in the past 2 years. The outgrowers produce 69% of all the tea that is produced in Uganda. That means now the processors, the big companies, produce something like 31%. You can see that there is a lot of tea that is coming out of these outgrowers, the people we call the small scale outgrowers. Now, like I said again, our quality is what the poor quality of our tea is what has brought us these
issues. Yes.
These issues. And besides the low consumption in the world market. We don't have the like I said in the beginning, we don't have the fertilizers. What mainly affects the quality of our tea is the fertilizer application. This is a crop that largely depends on fertilizer application. Once you don't apply, you don't get anything good out of this production. And now you look at you're getting, for example, in the past like 2 to 3 years. We were producing tea and selling a kilo of green leaf tea at around 670 shillings. And we were buying a 50 kilogram sack of fertilizer between 80 to 90,000. Now, when the price is low at between 150 and 200 shillings, now the price of fertilizer, the 50 kilogram sack, goes for 160,000. At one point, it had even shot to 200,000 shillings. So you realize that it does not make any economic sense.
How is your relationship with these factories and, of course, processors? Because it the way it used to happen, for example, in the coffee, it's something that we've been following somehow. You've just been depositing your seeds, I mean your beans, and then you are paid later. Yes. How is the arrangement with the factories, the farmers?
It is practically the same arrangement. Farmers take their tea to the factories. Actually, most factories come and collect from the farm gates.
From the farm gates.
Yeah, from the farm gates. But of course, again, the practices involved are also a little of poor quality in the collection, transportation, and processing of this tea.
Because I also wanted to find out, you know, the quality they were talking about.
Yes.
Is the quality a problem that is certainly within the farm? I mean, or it is actually also in storage, in transportation, and certainly where it goes. Paint for us a picture. How does, for example, an outgrower, you know, get to the price of 150, and how does that person actually get the tea into the factory?
Yeah, now that's actually the quality issue is along the value chain. The quality is right from the farm. The quality is not good, right? Its transportation to the factory is also not the best practice.
The quality of the seed.
The quality of the leaf.
The quality of the leaf
that is got out of the field is poor. And what brings about this is the lack of standardization about this quality. Now, in our language, we say that you should be plucking. A farmer should be plucking two leaves and a bud. We call it mbili na nusu, to have good quality tea.
Yes.
But some farmers pluck even break stems. Break stems.
Stems.
Yes, and some factories accept these stems. You see what the problem is. Now, on top of the bad quality tea that is coming from the gardens, poor transportation to the factory, and even processing practices. We are not privy to the processing practices, but what we are told is that it is also not the best. Some of the machines even are of old age, and they cannot cope with the current.
The machines at the factory.
They cannot cope with the current competitions that we are facing from other producers of tea. So we are saying the standard has gone down. Mm-hmm. One, from us, the farmers.
Yes.
And
you acknowledge that.
We acknowledge that.
On your part.
We acknowledge that.
Because there are no fertilizers, certainly, to give you the quality that you want.
Absolutely. There are no fertilizers given to us, but even those who have applied fertilizers. Because you will take your good quality tea to a factory. They will accept it. One factory. There is a factory will insist on good quality tea.
Yes.
Another one will not insist on the good quality tea. Now, if I take whatever I get from my field and I take to another factory and they accept it.
So the other factory will just put, literally it would be like contamination.
Absolutely.
Because it will go back to the same,
it will go
to the same market.
It is the same
Mombasa,
market.
Yes.
It is the same market. Now they will not say that this is good quality, it's from Uganda. They say all tea from Uganda is bad.
It's bad quality.
And as such, by the way, the players in Kenya, they are smart. They have taken advantage of that situation. Even if you produce good quality tea, they still brand it bad.
Bad.
Bad. Now that's the reason why we as farmers, outgrowers, have said, no, let us go out. Ourselves, we take the initiative to educate our farmers. We formed
because this is your product.
This is our product. We said no, this is not going to happen like it's continue happening like this. What we need to do, let us come together, all of us who are producing tea, let's come together. And we enlighten our farmers. We advocate for good prices, but we also teach our farmers on the good practices, good farming practices of
all
tea.
Right. I think Honorable Mbwate Kamwa must be already on standby and we want to find out whether actually the technical problem has been fixed. Honorable, thank you so much for joining us. And if you could just tell us how we got to this point where farmers are crying over low prices of tea. Good morning. I'm sorry, we can't get Honorable Mbwate Kamwa, but of course we'll be keeping on trying to see whether we can as well get him. It looks like he's on the way, on a road, maybe coming to legislate for your people. Barnabas.
Yes, my brother.
Let's talk about the issue of value addition, because we actually have been looking at, the president has always been talking about value addition on agricultural products.
Yes.
Looks like the age of just processing tea, taking it to the factory, and then later on it is taken to Mombasa, that age seems to be, getting outdated.
Yes.
It's getting in the past.
Yes.
What other value addition, you know, ways have you now devised to ensure that tea at least is locally consumed here?
Yes. Now, that's a very good question, my brother Mubarak. When we started getting hit by this trend, the sublime of the industry, we as farmers, outgrowers, we've started devising means of coming out of the pit, and we've been encouraging some of our farmers to venture into specialty teas, and also develop some cottage industries, small cottage industries, where we can get green tea. And it is, which is marketable.
Yes.
Yeah. People, everybody. Now people are moving away from the conventional CTC
black tea. That's very true. Yes.
Yes.
To green tea.
To green tea. Mm. And other specialties. There are white tea and so on and so forth. And we've been getting people to along the line to help us educate our farmers about this. And indeed, some farmers have started those small cottage industries. We have got women. Mm. Women, for example, actually, women are much ahead.
Yes,
are much ahead into this. They are developing. They are doing experiments and developing their own specialties. The other day, so we have got a group of women in IT, people from Mitoma, from Bushenyi district, from Kanungu, from Zombo, especially women, trying out on these specialties. I was moving and I saw on a small scale. Green tea, kakombe tea, green tea, yes. from Ushenyi, and these are people who are venturing into specialties and good green teas, which are marketable on the market. And only what they need is government intervention, government support.
We'll look at this. Of course, the intervention. I'm told that Honorable Mbwa is now got online. Honorable, thank you so much for joining us.
Hello, good morning.
Sorry for that technical problem. I know Shane is very far from Kampala. how is the situation
can you hear me now?
There? Yes, you are loud and clear.
Oh, good morning, viewers and listeners.
How did we get to a point? We saw you last time on the floor of Parliament, yes, telling government that you are going to start, advising farmers in your constituents to uproot tree plantations. How did we get to a point of getting into this, destroying crop and the tea that actually is a source of livelihood for the people that you represent?
First and foremost, I wish to thank the comrade you've hosted in the studio. He has tried to put out most of the things, but we came all to this because government has kept a deaf ear when it comes to crop, either it can be food crop or cash crop production. Government has given too much attention animal husbandry in this country. So the prices of tea started going down, of course, with effect from 2 years back. And at first, when we thought, because there was the Russia and Ukraine war, and we thought because Russia is among the consumers, so we thought that it would change. Then we saw what happened in Pakistan. Of course, we had some floods. We had some countries. So we thought things were going to get better. But we've realized that ever since the prices started going down, much as we try to inform the government about our problems, government has not dared to listen. Above all, since last year, we used to buy fertilizer because all we need to see what do we put in before we can even be given prices either 700 or 200. Tea in steel industry, you cannot plant tea and you don't put in inputs. Remember, this is a crop that you don't do intercropping. You only plant tea and that is tea. But if you want to harvest tea, you must put in fertilizers. You must apply fertilizers. And he has been speaking of quality. The major issue for quality, it begins in the field and it has to do with fertilizers. Because the moment you apply fertilizers, the green leaf is going to soften. And if you don't, it will not even give you the two leaves and the bud. You only pluck leaves and which are even hard leaves and even stem. So, a kilo of 50 kgs of fertilizer, a bag of 50 kgs, used to buy between 80 and it was between 70 and 80. Currently, a bag, the same bag of fertilizer, the cost is 240. And so we tried to engage the government. We say that now we cannot, no farmer can afford 240, which cannot even cover an acre. We requested the government to help us, and at least they tried to subsidize fertilizers the way they are subsidizing acaricides for animals, of which government promised that they were going to look into it, and they talked about Tororo factory for that they are trying to put up a factory for fertilizers. It's going to be cheap. It has now not been worked upon. There is another issue. There was the time we went with the Committee of Tourism to Mombasa. We found that the tea, the so-called tea, which they say it is a poor quality of ours from Uganda. They buy it at low price, blend it with other tea, even Kericho tea, and they sell it as Kericho tea and other even brands in the whole world. So I came, tabled the matter on the floor of Parliament, and the Prime Minister promised they were going to do something. On the same trip, we found that actually the warehouses our factories are using, these are Ugandan houses that were constructed, I think, during the reign of either Idi Amin, because, you know, Idi Amin was a very good planner. And these houses, they are now being managed by Uganda Property Holdings. And the minister in charge, of course, you remember this is a company by Guarantee. The minister in charge, now we can say Matia Kasaija and Anite, in charge of investments. Now they are the ones, when you look at those who are supposed to appear that have shares, they are the ones having shares on behalf of the government. We found that those warehouses were leased to Kenyans. And now Kenyans overcharge Ugandans for keeping their tea in their own home. I brought the matter. I said, we cannot accept this. These are Ugandan houses. Even our factories can manage to run them. If you want, they pay you, but we cannot accept. So you can imagine that tea, first and foremost, government has not looked for market anywhere. Our tea ends up in Mombasa. Above all, the storage is also expensive for people who are trying to sell our tea. So all in all that said, our farmers started experiencing low prices. He has said that we are given 200 shillings, but that 200 shillings is not even our money as farmers. A pracker, because they have even pride, you know, pracking a kilo of tea, it takes even good minutes. An experienced person can even take 10, 15 minutes to prack a kilo. So you find a good person who is a good pracker, even pracking 30 kgs a day, effective. So for them, they are taking 150. A farmer, remember, you're putting in inputs, you're putting in herbicides, pesticides. So we cannot break even. So some of us have decided to uproot tea. And personally, I've already uprooted 10 acres. I want to substitute it with coffee and matoke because I can do intercropping. And what we need people to know, that farmers, unlike any other crop, maybe, tea is a perishable crop. If you pluck it in the morning, after 2 hours before it is even collected, it will even lose the potency. I think we can say potency. It will lose that value, and they might not take it. And if they don't take it, you don't have where to put it. But with any other crop like coffee, you can store if the prices are low.
Honorable Gaffer, before you uproot your tea plantations, I want to take a short break. But certainly you and I know that tea is one of the major, foreign exchange earners. I think the third agricultural product, after I think coffee. So you know how much importance it is, especially to the country and certainly to the livelihood of Ugandans. But I want you to react on the issue of what interventions need to be done. And certainly, Barnabas has been talking about regulations. We have seen certainly other crops being regulated. Coffee has a development authority and all that. And also we have seen the rationalization of government agencies, including certainly Coffee Development Authority and all that. I want us to look at certainly what needs to be done to ensure that this is resolved. But after taking this very, very short break, just keep online. I'll come back to you in just a short while. Have a good morning. Welcome back to Rush Hour. We are discussing the tea industry and how farmers are certainly about to uproot some tea plantations, which is a very bad thing because some factories have closed and the prices of the tea at the farm gate is dropping each day that passes. With me in the studio is Atunom Hanj Barnabas, is, of course, the company secretary for the Outgrowers Association company, and also the Honorable Mbwate Kamwagafa, Member of Parliament for Igara West in Bushenyi District, one of the leading farming districts in terms of tea. Barnabas, before we went for a break, I was still actually asking Honorable Mbwa that tea is a very, very important product.
Yes.
In fact, the third agriculture earner, sure. foreign exchange earner. Which must certainly be handled with care. What interventions and where else can we, so for example, find markets? Because when we're having dairy products as a problem here, when Kenya was banning our products from getting in there, the president actually was talking about finding alternative markets. We saw him going to Algeria, and Algeria was actually willing to take our dairy products. When we had issues with coffee, the same thing. Oil, the same thing. We are now exploring routes in Tanzania. What are the alternative markets and what are the alternative ways to ensure that our tea actually retains its prices? And certainly farmers are not so much demotivated to get to the point of what Honorable Mbwa is talking about.
Yeah, like we said, my brother Mubarak, it's a very precarious situation for a tea farmer. And as an association of all tea outgrowers in the country, we've been trying to synergize our efforts towards the stabilization of this subsector of the tea growing. There are quite a number of interventions we've been proposing. By the way, we've been having engagements with key stakeholders in the government, ministries, the Prime Minister's office, and quite a number of other stakeholders, and we've been engaging. And a number of interventions have been proposed at various fora. One, of course, is regulation and formulation and development of a tea policy, which government has done. And even before, so many years ago, a tea policy was formulated and later on shelved in cabinet. Of recent, they have again brought it up, and quite a number of engagements have been held by the Ministry of Agriculture and that of Trade and Industry in different regions, and it culminated in one that came here in Kampala, all in line to formulate the policy. But it has not seen any light. Again, we are told that is in cabinet. There are quite a number of things that we may talk about it, but due to limited time, I'll stop at that. And the major intervention that we need now as tea farmers is about the enforceability of tea green leaf standards, among others. The enforcement of the tea green leaf standard. How do we want that done in the shortest term? We've got long-term proposals and short-term proposals. The short-term proposal about this is that we think that once we have got a standard crop, good quality, eventually we shall have a good price for the tea and our farmers we will benefit. It's a bad situation. Honorable Mbwate Kamwa is my MP, has uprooted, and this is a leader. Now, once that is done, and quite a number of others have uprooted, you cannot have something for years, year in, year out, and you're not getting anything. You have children take back to school. We have got people who entirely rely on this crop to educate their children for medication, for food, and everything. And they are completely starving, and some of them properties have been put on market to be auctioned.
Yeah.
So once we feel, once we have that intervention, and we, for example, in the short term, we think that if Ministry of Agriculture and that of Trade and Industry come together and go through, for example, UNBS, Uganda National Bill of Standards, and they say, let us have this regulation about the standard, the tea, green tea leaf standard. If you, all factories across don't accept anything beyond this, and they maintain it. By the way, we are talking of policy, we are talking of regulations. Rwanda does not have a deliberate policy, but they have got a deliberate regulation. They say we are regulating, this is the quality that we want. Not necessarily that have got a policy. Policy formulation takes a long process,
a long time.
But they maintain that, and they are enjoying. Whereas for last year, we are shutting it down. Mm-hmm. For them, they are enjoying their side.
So it's quite ironic that
it is.
You are, the government was actually promoting more, quantities.
They encouraged
more quantities.
Yes.
And certainly after quantities have been realized, now the issue is with quality and certainly with the prices.
Yes.
Let me engage Honorable Gaffer on that same point. You know, it was good that actually government was encouraging, more production of tea and all of that.
Mm.
What interventions are needed as of now to ensure that we get out of this crisis?
Thank you so much. First and foremost, what do we need as urgent? Well, we've seen the 9 factories that have closed down and yet are yet to close because of the cost of production is very high. Take an example. A cost of a kilowatt unit of electricity for those factories that are not in industrial gazetted zones, they are paying 3,400 and some cents per unit kilowatt. Unlike the factories which are in industrial parks, that you find they are paying a kilowatt of electricity at 1,900 and some cents. So we are saying, government, we generate power in Uganda. We are not importing this power. President Museveni has been bragging over that when he came, he found there were some few megawatts. Now we have how many dams? But it is very unfortunate that this power is not affordable to Ugandans, not even to factories. It is very expensive for any Ugandan to afford. So we are saying all those factories that are also in that sector, government should come up with a plan, and they also they subsidize electricity such that they can also use cheaper electricity and they run their factories. We are saying the factories must get immediate bailout. If last year we managed to get foreign earnings of more than $100 billion, what are we saying, million dollars? What are we saying that we cannot, out of that, get and judge each factor according to what it has been producing, and government gives a bailout depending on production capacity, maybe 2 billion per factory, or 3 depending on the production. And how does that come? That is our cardinal role as member of parliament. Government can come up with a supplementary of which we can also pass, and government can get that money to bail out those factories to make sure that they keep up in business. The way we are trying, we've passed a supplementary to buy vaccines for foot and mouth disease, and it was not on the budget. That's how we want it.
That's Honorable Mbatekama, and of course we'll get back to you, that we still actually experiencing some network issues. Now, Honorable is talking about actually bailout. That is something that many people have actually talked about. They are, foreign investors who are having incentives here and there, but looks like some of the proposals may not be practical. For example, like a bailout of giving them money. What is the more practical way or remedies actually to sort out this issue?
Yeah, Mr. Mbarak, I don't think that is practically impossible for government to bail out these companies, these processors. Yeah, you read recently, must have read, it was a headline in the New Vision, 9 factories have closed down. Closed down. And we don't think that government is happy about that.
Yeah.
You know what goes along with the closure of
unemployment and all that.
Absolutely. Mm. And government, of course, loses out also. It should be getting some revenues from it in form of taxes. Now, government can really if it was so willing, it can make a deliberate move to bail out these companies so that the farmers don't close down completely. The likes of us don't uproot our tea. It can set, indeed, like he says, he has said in Parliament, they can look out for a bailout somehow. They can look for the funds to do that. We also have a proposal that government can help us, the farmers, who are closing down, who are shutting down, who are uprooting our tea, by providing a fund, what we call a stabilization fund, and put somewhere.
I thought the stabilization, the bailout should be on the part of the processors. Not the part of the farmers.
No, even the farmers.
That would be certainly too much.
It's not too much, my brother. It's not too much. We are saying the factories can be helped to come out. By the way, some of them are heavily laden by debts. We think that if government came about and helped them to overcome this problem of debt and keep them afloat, they will in the same vein help farmers.
In other words, restructuring their debts?
Probably restructuring their debts. Of course, not completely paying off completely, but they can restructure their debts so that they keep afloat. Secondly, they can put a small fund, to help these farmers, the outgrowers, who I said form 69% of all the total output in Uganda. So that instead of a farmer getting 150, 200, and yet has got to put in inputs, fertilizer and so on, let the farmer get at least 300 shillings. 300 shillings, so that 100 goes to the plucker, 200 goes to the farmer, and he is able to pay for the inputs. But at the same time, we are saying that let government, in its own wisdom, help to discount, to subsidize fertilizers. Like we said, fertilizer is the main component of tea production. If you are going to have good quality tea, you cannot do it without application of fertilizer. Now, government can come in and subsidize. This was done in Kenya. Kenya has done it, has discounted the fertilizer, and the farmers are okay, they are producing very good quality tea. So we think that if government takes a deliberate move and subsidize on our fertilizer, a bag which is 140, 160, you know, there are different players in the market.
Yeah.
Some producers distribute at 180, 160. They are taking advantage, of course. These are middlemen. These are business people. If government could come and discount on this fertilizer and provide a subsidy for us so that we get it at a reduced cost, so that we can apply to our gardens, I'm very sure that we shall have solved that problem of poor quality of our tea. That's one of the interventions.
Yes. So you are looking at certainly government keeping you in the business that is already existing. But it looks like you're not looking at devising other ways. We saw recently in the coffee industry where actually people were suggesting. You remember the company that was even given actually billions to teach Ugandans how to drink coffee.
Probably should also be given to teach people how to drink.
There are actually other likely interventions which are local in nature, which may not necessarily need a lot of money or even government to strain its resource envelope. For farmers, for example, to devise means of how to, do some kind of local processing within their own gardens.
Yes. I mentioned this earlier, Mr. Mubarak. I mentioned it that our farmers...
The green tea you're talking about actually be made at home.
Yes, small cottages. You get your one room in your house and you produce green tea. You get in the garage, you produce tea. This is at a small scale. A number of them are doing it. I told you I saw recently tested very good, delicious, with a good aroma, a green tea, kakombe green tea. So now we are saying if government could, and there are quite a number of such people. I told you women who are doing it, in Mitoma, women in Kanungu, women in Nzombo. Women in Nzombo, for example, government encouraged them to open up their land for tea farming. They did not think about putting a processing facility there to process their tea. And the women, they say now, this thing is in place. Government has.
It is homegrown, local-based.
Local-based. What do we do? Government has not come in to help us. Women started in Zombo. Women started processing their own tea. They are supplying the whole of Western region with tea, Southern Sudan, Eastern Congo, their own locally made tea, locally processed tea. And we are saying that if government could come out and identify these people and encourage them and help them and fund them, these are people who need small capital to expand on their production. And in a way, government will keep people afloat in the business. These people will expand, and eventually, ultimately, the government will definitely get revenues from these people.
I want to bring it back, Honorable Gaffer. If honestly you are online, we can as well wrap up this conversation. Honorable, are you still there? Honorable Mbwate Kamwa, Member of Parliament for Igara West in Bushenyi District, one of the leading, I think is actually somehow on a different line. We have to wind up this conversation, Barnabas. What in the meantime are you doing to help the outgrowers to actually navigate through this problem as we are winding up? But I'm told actually Honorable Gaffer is online. Good morning again, Honorable Gaffer.
Morning.
Let's wind up this conversation. So what is the way forward, and what are you doing in the National Assembly to ensure that actually people are getting out of this crisis?
I don't know where I had reached, because I realized I was speaking, but later I was off air. So if you can help me understand, if to repeat the whole, I don't know. Anyway, but all I'm saying briefly is that government, as government, it has something that it can do. First and foremost, our cardinal role is to legislate. Okay? Hello?
Yes, I hear you. Go ahead.
Our cardinal role is to legislate. So if government comes up with a policy that is going to address the issue of quality, our role is to pass the policy such that it can help us have address the issue of quality. Because it is very easy. What does it take for a policy to come? Government, the first policy, put it in shelves. Now, the second policy is very unfortunate that the other Thursday when I raised the matter, Honorable Minister Bahat promised that he was going to, they are going to cabinet, and is going to come up with an answer this Thursday, which is, I think, tomorrow. But it is very unfortunate that even in the cabinet, they never discussed anything to do with tea. This is what tells you that it is a deliberate plan for government to leave out farmers and concentrate on pastoralists. So it can do that. We are saying that the electricity is hardly affordable by these factories. A unit of power per kilowatt for these factories, they buy it over 3,400 and some cents. Then you find the same unit of the factories that are running within a gazetted industrial area, they are buying a unit per kilowatt of 1,900. So we are saying we are not importing power in Uganda. We have so many, many dams that President Museveni has been bragging around that when he came, they were producing few megawatts, and now we have so much. If we are having so much
to construct them,
if we are having so much, how come that electricity is hardly affordable in Uganda? What is the essence of having so much? You have so many banana plantations in your field, but your children can hardly afford a meal. What is the essence? It does not augur well. So we are saying power should be, they need subsidized power for these factories such that they can break through. We are saying that for us farmers, we need to get subsidies the way Kenya subsidized agricultural inputs for their farmers to make sure that they can benefit. We cannot be in tea industry. And we bring all these foreign earnings. But the government is like, it wants to milk a cow without giving it even food. But it is interested in the milk. That's how it is looking at us. So we are saying, any factory that has been in production, depending on what it has been producing, should get a bailout of maybe they can calculate according to what it has been producing and they get bailouts like either 2 billion. And this is not much compared to what we are producing. Because if they shut down, our people are going to lose jobs. Our people are not going to pay as you earn, because government does not even benefit from that one. People are paying pay as you earn. People, they are paying statutory obligations, the NSSF, they are remitting, such that when people are old, age, they are going even to benefit, not to disturb the government. So we are saying that each factory should get immediate bailout. Government should come with a supplementary plan, and we are here to support as members of parliament. as we supported a supplementary plan to buy vaccines over 50 billion for cows. Even we're also human beings, and government, if it is saying it is valuing tea, we must come on board. Another program, what I think we can do, government should also market tea. Last, I think it was last year, government came to parliament and they were having a plan of promoting drinking coffee in Uganda. I've never seen any plan where government is trying to promote tea drinking in this country. So it means that even the government itself does not value tea, since it has never made any promotion to make sure that our tea can be drunk. We are also saying another intervention which is immediate. The warehouses which were built by President Idi Amin should also immediately be given free to as warehouses in Mombasa for our people not to pay. And they should even be run by Ugandans, because Kenyans are running them. They are third parties. They are getting a lot of money and they are overcharging Ugandans, so the cost goes so high. And that intervention should be so immediate. We need.
Thank you so much.
Yes.
Thank you so much, Honorable Mbatekama, Member of Parliament for Igara West in Bushenji District. Barnabas, let's wind up this conversation. It looks like Honorable Mbatekama was looking at it from a much policy level and at a parliamentary level. From your outgrowers, the members who are actually within your association, what recommendations would you give them and what is the way forward?
Yes, thank you very much, my brother. First of all, I want to applaud our members of parliament, especially from the tea growing areas. They are making loud noise. Honorable Gaffa is making loud noise in parliament and even another stakeholder forum. Honorable Annette Mugisha has done the same in parliament. There's also Honorable Ruhunda Alex from Fort Potro making loud noise in parliament about it. We applaud them. As the Uganda Tea Outgrowers Association, we feel sad when we see our members uprooting the tea. We feel very, very sad. It took them a lot to plant this tea, and it is very, very sad. By the way, even uprooting, it is a cost, a very huge cost in uprooting. It is very, very sad. So now we want to implore government to come to our rescue immediately. One, we cannot overemphasize the issue of coming in with regulation. Two, we feel that if government, it does not take a lot, this government, to subsidize the fertilizer, to apply to our gardens. I don't want to overemphasize it. We also, we have a proposal. The Honorable Prime Minister has been meeting us, the farmers, and she's been promising us a lot. We understand the other day she even mentioned it on the floor of parliament that as government, they have attracted some investors from the Middle East. I think Airlight Agro is a company which is coming to establish some factories. But we are saying, how about if they came and found that we have already uprooted all the tea? So now let government come in and intervene. One, they provide us, like I said, stabilization fund.
Yes.
Let the farmers be given some amount of money. Government can provide, can find a way of how to channel it. The way they are doing it, PDM. They can find a way of channeling some small funds of money so that these farmers can get at least a minimum of their farm gate price. Put at maybe 300,000. One, they have already subsidized the fertilizer and herbicides as well. They put it somewhere so that at least the farmer can get something. Can get something
before actually they approach.
Absolutely. Then we also think that if we got a desk as tea farmers strictly positioned in any government ministry, we are proposing that Honorable Nabanja is taking the lead, including our MP from Bushenyi, Honorable Magezi Rafael. If we could have, if they could create for us a desk, a tea desk, maybe in the Prime Minister's office, and it is specifically looking into the issues of tea farmers, we feel that maybe.
Your issues can as well
be addressed. But again, above all, we want we're imploring government to come in and identify these people. We have as smallholder farmers, we are encouraging our farmers, our members to go into cottage industries. Let government come to the rescue of these people to their aid, not destruction. In this case, we want them to come to their aid. We want government to come to their aid and help them to get some small funding and expand on it. On their production, we feel that in that way, as they also look at other opportunities, other areas, marketing our tea outside, and so on and so forth, we feel that the tea industry it can be stabilized somewhere.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Barnabas, for spending time to speak to us. And thank you so much, Honorable Mbatekama Gaffa from Bushenyi. We are going to take a short break. When we return, Rush Talk comes in with Maisra Miti. Good morning.